The next item on the order paper is a motion on the absence of executive ministers. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the matter motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly notes that the Minister for Social Development, the Minister for Regional Development, the Minister of Health, Social Services and Public Safety and the Minister of Enterprise, Trade and Investment have resigned and resumed office more than 20 times since the 10th of September 2015, believes that this practice of rolling resignations has had a significant and detrimental effect on the governance of Northern Ireland and on the public's faith in the political institutions, and further believes that engaging in this practice of rolling resignations amounts to a breach of the terms of the pledge of office.
I call Mr. Chris Little to move the motion.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I move the motion somewhat reluctantly today, but I do think this is an important opportunity for MLAs to state clearly that there are members of this Assembly, there are ministers in the Executive who are working to deliver effective power-sharing government and are committed to supporting rule of law in our community. We recognise that there are serious issues to be addressed, our budget and public finance challenges, the need to take responsibility for difficult decisions around welfare reform, and of course to ensure that we work together to tackle all forms of paramilitarism in our society. But I fail to see how the resignations that we have seen, the Ulster Unionist Party resignation, but in particularly the DUP approach to rolling resignations, are doing anything other than damage fragile public confidence in our Assembly, imperil our public services, and indeed they may well be a breach of the ministerial pledge of office, which requires ministers to discharge their duties in good faith, to participate fully in the Executive and to be accountable to the Assembly. Despite that, we have seen the absurd situation of the DUP Minister for Enterprise, for example, coming to the Chamber, albeit on important matters in relation to renewable energy and credit unions, and yet the Minister for Health continuing to refuse to respond and take up his ministerial responsibility to show strategic leadership on urgent issues such as spiralling hospital waiting lists that in any other jurisdiction would indeed see urgent action taken in order to address those. We believe that this part-time theatre politics has to stop and that we have to get back to dealing with the serious issues that need to be addressed. We don't see how walking away from ministerial responsibility for delivering strategic leadership in our public services is doing what is right for the people of Northern Ireland. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, the Alliance Party did reluctantly accept the proposal for a short adjournment of the Assembly, but we certainly would not have supported and do not support the abdication of ministerial responsibility for our public services or the rolling resignation policy that is bringing the Executive into further disrepute. I would like to place on record my party's revulsion at the heinous murders of Jared Davison and Kevin McGuigan and our concern at the suggestion that members of the Provisional IRA were involved. Where there has been evidence of any party political paramilitary connection in the past, the Alliance Party has not hesitated to take action, and we have previously supported the exclusion of Sinn Féin during previous talks processes and Assembly mandates. So we will not be found wanting in that respect. But we did not at any point propose action that would prevent key decision making in executive departments. The running of our public services should not be subject to political whims, but they should be, the serious allegations in connection to the Provisional IRA should not be allowed to plunge our public services into crisis as well as our institutions. There is mounting evidence that the DUP's actions are affecting the governance of Northern Ireland. One of these, as I have mentioned, is the ridicule that is being heaped on this institution, and it is deeply damaging to public confidence for key ministries. Equally worrying is the impact on public services, and deeply concerned, by, like many others, about this development. Perhaps most pressing, however, is the inability to agree a monitoring round due to the failure of the executive to meet. The increase in waiting lists is deeply concerning to many people in our community, and indeed the Chief Executive of the Health and Social Care Board spoke openly about the challenges facing our health service in regards to waiting lists and the need for significant additional investment from the monitoring round to help reduce this immediate issue. This monitoring round has not been agreed by the executive in June, and indeed it would appear that October monitoring round will also be missed, and that the best we can hope for is to work towards a January monitoring round. This is not the only example of issues in relation to our health service. It's my understanding that a joint strategy on domestic and sexual violence has been agreed by the Minister for Justice and requires urgent approval of the Minister for Health. It's also my understanding that in the Ministry for Social Development we have seen a delay in legislation in relation to regeneration powers, in relation to housing and in relation to pensions. These bills may not have the same immediacy as the growing waiting lists in our community, but their passage, however, would be important for the lives of many people in Northern Ireland. They are just some examples of the delay and the pressure that is being put on our public services that are having a significant detrimental effect on the governance and the people of Northern Ireland. There is also a much wider range of aspects of ministerial office that are being neglected in terms of policy accountability and leadership. The lack of ministerial presence also prevents departments from responding to events and indeed to a number of question times here in the Assembly when we seek to raise urgent issues and hold our departments to account. I've also been concerned by the DUP suggestion that it doesn't really matter if ministers are in post or not. Not only is this untrue, it's disingenuous, but it also rather bizarrely suggests that the DUP are at best lukewarm about the impact their ministers are making. To my mind, the continued executive absences may well constitute a breach of the ministerial pledge of office. The process of taking up office, safe in the knowledge that a resignation will issue within 24 hours, does bring into disrepute whether that office is being accepted with the good faith to discharge duties, to participate fully in the executive, the North-South Ministerial Council and the British-Irish Council. And accepting office with no intention... Yes, I give way.
I thank the member for giving way. And does he agree it highlights yet again the need for a process to investigate breaches of the ministerial code?
Thank the member for his intervention. I think that is an important point to make. Independent investigation of potential breaches of the ministerial code and some form of enforcement appear urgently needed, given the mockery that is being made of it at this current moment in time. Accepting office with no intention to attend executive meetings or North-South Ministerial Council is a serious concern. I also believe that the Ministerial Code of Conduct requires ministers to be accountable for activities within their responsibility, their stewardship of public funds, and the extent to which key performance is being met by their department. If a minister accepts office knowing that they will be unable to perform these roles, to answer questions, to attend committees, or give account to MLAs for their actions, then they have clearly brought into question their commitment to that pledge of office. It is important that we remember that accountability for their inaction is as important as accountability for their actions. For these reasons, I would ask the Assembly to consider passing this motion and to make it clear that we believe that the now you see them, now you don't approach to politics is not acceptable. Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker.
Call Ms. Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. The events of recent weeks where respective DUP MLAs became momentary ministers have only further lowered the public reputation of this Assembly and the institutions. No one could be oblivious that these last few weeks have caused real and lasting harm. On Wednesday, the 26th of August, the Ulster Unionist Party announced our decision to withdraw from the Northern Ireland Executive, to form an opposition and to offer people an alternative, as is the way in any normal democracy. We all know the background to this was a statement from the PSNI Chief Constable. He stated that members of the Provisional IRA were involved in the murder of a man in East Belfast, and that an infrastructure still exists at a senior level of the Provisional IRA. The blanket denial from Sinn Féin about all of this meant that we had to act, and we acted decisively. The Ulster Unionist Party is not in denial about the existence of any paramilitary organisation. When we withdrew from the Northern Ireland Executive, we explicitly called on the UDA, UVF and the rest to go away, taking their paramilitary flags and markings with them. However, they are not in the Northern Ireland, the Executive of Northern Ireland. Sinn Féin are, and if this institution is to retain any credibility, and if we accept the word of the Chief Constable implicating still active members of the Provisional IRA, still inextricably linked to Sinn Féin, the murder of a man on the streets of Belfast, then true Democrats cannot and should not tolerate this. The DUP's imminent response was predictable. They took their historic position of blaming the Ulster Unionist Party, and has been pointed out in their early statements about an exclusion motion against Sinn Féin was nonsense and unworkable under their St Andrews agreement. Ironic that yet another aspect of that agreement has come back to bite that party the hardest. Their other fudge was to seek the adjournment of the Assembly. When that failed, they acted in the most ham-fisted and stupid way possible. The First Minister did not resign, he merely stepped aside. The Finance Minister stayed in post to keep an eye on so-called rogue or renegade behaviour in the Executive and took on the First Minister's position, though not when it comes to signing documents, apparently. Then the other DUP ministers resigned and then reappointed, as the motion says more than 20 times. Wikipedia can barely keep up. All this nonsense has been done in the interest of the DUP, not in the interest of Northern Ireland. For the past month, the focus has been on the nonsense of the in-out, hokey-cokey, yo-yo ministers. Instead of a health minister at his desk tackling the going crisis in our hospitals, or coming to this chamber and responding to Ulster Union's debates on waiting times and the delays in cancer services or the SDLP autism motion. What we have seen instead is often seen calmly wandering through the corridors upstairs. The fact that 1 in 5 of the population, or 373,000 people to be specific, I'll give way.
Thank the member for giving way, and I agree with her in her characterisation of what's happened since the DUP started their hokey-cokey antics. Does the member not agree with me, though, that the UUP stepping out of the executive and handing that department, the Regional Development Department, which is very, very important, handing it over to a minister that isn't even going to turn up for work? Do you not agree with me that that is a dereliction of duty, allowing a hokey-cokey minister to come in one day and out the next, when your party could be in there working and trying to provide the infrastructure that we all need for places like my city and Derry?
The member has an extra minute.
Can I thank the member for giving it? No, I don't agree with him. My party has never shied away from taking the difficult decisions and never will. So the fact that 1 in 5 of the population, or 373,000 people, are waiting on treatment, a hospital appointment or a diagnostic test was not only weighing down on his conscience, Mr Principal Deputy Speaker, the disgrace of how the DUP have acted over recent weeks was clearly illustrated last week. Whilst the DUP and their ministers had repeatedly failed to take part in major debates or bills, they all rushed in to vote down the reduction of SPAD salaries. Talk about putting party interests ahead of matters of real public importance. I can think of no clear image of the DUP acting in a more selfish, arrogant or contemptuous manner as they did last week. Shame on them, and when they ultimately do take up their ministerial posts again, using the report on paramilitaries as a fig leaf, they shouldn't think that all will be forgiven. People will long remember the actions of the DUP in the last few weeks, undemocratic, un-British and unworthy of office. Thank you.
I call Ms. Rosie McCauley.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. And like others, I welcome the opportunity to have this debate in the Assembly today, because I believe it's unacceptable that we have ministers who aren't ministers, or they are sometimes ministers, and that that method of trying to engage in politics is just unacceptable. It's wrong, and it's not fulfilling the pledge of office that people committed themselves to. I would like to focus on the role of the Health Minister as a member of the Health Committee, and we have many serious issues in the health department that need addressed, and no health minister in place in an important department like the health department is just wrong, and it doesn't give the leadership to constituents who elected him to lead and to make those decisions and to resolve the serious issues that face the health department. That is just not acceptable. Health has the biggest budget of all the departments, $4.6 billion, and it employs over 54,000 people, and you could argue that it affects everybody in society. So a minister being in place for half an hour a week or whatever period of time he comes into office is just not good enough. And what the minister said on the 11th of May was that he would continue to drive the momentum for change across the health service. He said there would be tough decisions ahead, but I will not shy away from doing what's right. And I think he is completely going against his own stated word, and he needs to get back to his desk. And just to talk about the reform that's needed in the health service, there's duplication in commissioning, there's a lack of accountability, a lack of clarity in decision making, and the system as it is configured means that the department can say it wants to protect frontline services but allows the trusts to cut those very services. These are serious issues that need to be addressed. And over the last weeks, with no minister, we've heard from many sectors and individuals who depended on ministerial decisions. The All-Ireland Network on Children's Heart Services need investment in the Clark Clinic. The majority of children are still going to England for surgery. The business case is on his desk, but who is making that decision? Similarly, there's recommendations made by the Older People's Commissioner which will reform, or which will certainly make things better for older people in residential homes and who depend on domiciliary care. But he's ignored that report up to now. I don't even know if it is even on his desk. So these are big issues. On Saturday there was a protest from junior doctors. They need clarity around what way their working conditions are going to be. That needs to be addressed because they're unsafe and unfair. A recent Transform Your Care policy forum heard from a packed room calling for leadership and reform of the system. GPs is another area that needs to be resolved. We've spoken about this in the past couple of weeks in this Assembly. There is a looming crisis in the GP sector, and no minister in place to even look at the issue is just shameful. And there's also issues around legislation, around regulation of social care and a ban on smoking in cars, and that's all failing to move forward because the minister isn't in office. So the situation has turned farcical, but for the many patients and others who depend on health service, it isn't farcical, it's just a calamity. And much has also been said about welfare cuts. So is the minister now actually saying that we take the money off the vulnerable and disabled to pay for the health service? These are just conditions and circumstances that just can't be allowed to continue. And other members have referred here today to the ministerial pledge. all ministers, including DUP ministers, took a pledge of office, and that pledge of office requires them to represent all people and be accountable to everyone, not to their own political party, and that's exactly what's happening here. So, the ministerial code says they must at all times be accountable to users of services, and they must ensure that all reasonable requests for information by the Assembly and others are responded to. Now, many members have put in questions to the ministers and have been told that they can't be answered because the minister isn't in office. Currently, the mental capacity bill is being processed, but questions for the health minister to respond have been rejected as well. So serious implications because of this. I support this motion here today.
As question time begins at 2 p.m, I suggest that the House takes its ease until then. The debate will continue after question time, when the next member to speak will be Mr. Fergal McKinney.
So let us return now to the debate on the absence of executive ministers. Very appropriate. And I call Mr. Fergal McKinney. Point of order, and if it's an apology, I will accept it in advance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I welcome this opportunity to participate in this debate, and I do so as SDLP health spokesperson. Before making my comments focusing on the health issues, I'd like to make a number of wider points, principally on the nature of DUP abstentionism. Peter's out, but Arlene's in twice. The party's putting pounds before patients by keeping the finance ministry open while pretending to be in and out of health. Jonathan is out, but he's in when he's out of the country. You couldn't literally, Mr. Speaker, make it up. We've held a number of very important debates in this chamber in the last number of weeks. Autism, which affects many thousands of young people and their families. Cancer, which clearly reaches into all levels of society here. And SPADS has a much more limited audience. So the DUP were absent for the first two, which had the public interest at their core, but did turn up for the much narrower and self-interested SPAD issue. And I notice social media's outrage. This morning I listened to the BBC News and was intrigued to hear a DUP contribution on this debate today on the airwaves. So the DUP's happy enough to go to the radio stations, but they're not happy to turn up in the chamber. In my view, this is perpetrating a deceit on the public, pretending that they're making a contribution, while of course they are not. Ultimately, the fact that the DUP has either turned up to vote on issues or participate narrowly on others shows there's no principle at the heart of this particular approach. The party has continued to put enormous public concern over issues such as health second in favour of a spat between themselves and the Ulster Unionist Party over who is taking the hardest unionist line. We all agree that the current situation we find ourselves in out in society is not a pleasant one, but it's not a situation that should allow ministers to abandon their posts, to abandon the public and to abandon the democratic process. And in terms of health, we've seen that translated down into elective care, we've seen it translated down into cancer services and autism. And instead we have a smokescreen while the minister turns up for 5 or 10 minutes to do a small bit of business to make it look as if the bigger bit has been done. And the public aren't blind, and the public aren't fools, and the issues are not restricted to those that I've listed. There are others, the availability of cancer drugs, the transforming your care plan, the very plan at the heart, the strategic difference that that would make if it was being properly driven, the well-deserved pay rise for health staff, and the more recent focus in on the ambulance air ambulance service here, and punitive changes to junior doctors' contracts is another issue which is now coming to the surface. And can I take a moment just to congratulate all of those who turned out at the weekend to support our junior doctors, but not just to support them, but in fact to support the NHS overall. If the DUP's in-out approach, Mr. Speaker, says anything, it's that the strategy has not been properly thought through. And it's been an attempt to pull the wool over patients and the public eyes. It's not worked. Indeed, they said that the reason they were doing this was to put a focus on the murders which have been talked about earlier in contributions here.
Well, if it's done anything, it has taken focus off those horrendous murders, which we should all quite rightly be abhorred at. So by any measure, their own strategy has cataclysmically failed. We have no leadership and no strategy. Health staff, the public and patients continue to be failed. Where else would it be acceptable to have a part-time health minister as we continue to witness the crisis after crisis that I've outlined? It's important to remember that these ministries, all occupied by the DUP, retain the key policy levers that are paramount in dealing with the long-term issues facing Northern Ireland. Part of this morning's contribution elsewhere said those who had supported the concept of an assembly adjournment, the Alliance Party, had no room to criticise the DUP when it took further escalation measures. Well, Mr Speaker, to remind the House, the SDLP objected completely and unanimously to the concept of an adjournment, and by the DUP's own logic is therefore in a stronger position to criticise its in-out approach today. It is letting down patients.
Reluctant to get drawn into a war of words, given the purpose of today is to send out a clear message that MLAs and ministers do want to work in the best interests of people in Northern Ireland, but given the member has criticised the Alliance Party, does he accept that an abdication of responsibility to take difficult decisions on welfare reform is damaging our community just as much as the abdication of actual ministerial office?
Thank you very much, Mr Speaker. I think the member may have misinterpreted. I was reflecting on, while I would have my own criticisms over your party's support of the adjournment process, actually I was making the point that the DUP were saying that you had little room to criticise when they escalated their approach beyond that. I'm contrasting the SDLP's robust approach, its very robust approach, that it wants these assembly institutions running. We do not accept the principle of adjournment, and therefore, uniquely perhaps, we're the only party in this chamber that can actually stand here and say this is wrong in terms of adjournment and it's wrong in terms of escalation procedures. And as I say, wrong from a strategic perspective, because the party that adopted that process wanted or claimed that it was going to bring focus in on murders, when in fact it's brought only focus on its own failed strategy. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
And I thank the members for bringing this motion to the Assembly today. Mr Speaker, we need to remind ourselves of the timeline of the DUP strategy, if you want to call it a strategy, the hokey-cokey strategy of resigning and reappointing ministers. When the Ulster Unionist Party decided to withdraw from the executive, my colleague, Minister Danny Kennedy, resigned, the DUP had no intention of following suit. They made noises about excluding Sinn Féin from the executive, yet they knew fine well that under St Andrew's Agreement, the possibility of excluding Sinn Féin from the executive through an assembly motion simply did not exist. I remind members that when we withdrew from the executive, we did so cleanly and clearly on a point of principle. The point of principle being the complete undermining of trust in the serial denial of Sinn Féin in wake of the implication of a still operational provisional IRA in the McGuigan murder. If we look at the public statements coming from various DUP spokesmen in late August, early September, it is abundantly clear they had no intention of withdrawing from the executive, which would have triggered assembly elections. No intention whatsoever. Sammy Wilson stated on the 20th of August that the UUP's decision to leave government is cowardly rather than courageous and self-serving rather than selfless. It is premature and opportunist. This is a time for sensible leadership, not knee-jerk reactions. How Sammy must regret those comments. On the 7th of September, Peter Robinson stated, "If it becomes apparent to us that a satisfactory resolution in the talks is not possible, then as we indicated in our earlier statement, as a last resort, ministerial resignations will fall." And the day after, Mrs. Foster attacked my party leader, stating, one day Mike Nesbitt's in the executive, next day he's out of it. One day he's in the talks, next day he's out of it. The next morning, on the 9th of September, she belated the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party and Lady Ulster. Unfortunately for her, just minutes before news broke of a certain Mr. Copeland being arrested and Mr. Story joining him. The 9th of September then, we're told that if the adjournment of the Assembly does not happen, or as an alternative, the Secretary of State does not suspend the Assembly, then the DUP ministerial resignations will follow. However, the next day we're told by Peter Robinson he is therefore standing aside as First Minister, and other DUP members, ministers will resign with immediate effect, with the exception of Arlene Foster. There's no record from the DUP on their website or any other means of this tactic to resign and then take up their ministerial positions. The DUP can shout and yell at fellow unionists. The truth is, the guiding principle through all the past weeks at all cost is to protect the DUP. Their so-called clever tactic is all about self-preservation. That is always their motivation. The mantra is, the party comes first. The fact is that their occasional hard-line rhetoric, through it all, the DUP have been joined at the hip with Sinn Féin in a carve-up of this dysfunctional executive for the past 8 years. The member, glad we give way.
Thank the member for giving way. I find his analysis of another party being that he's trying to criticise being joined at the hip when the Sinn Féin, whenever his party was joined at the hip, stroke inextricably linked to the DUP at only the last Westminster election. Can I also ask him, I appreciate the aim of doing what's right for Northern Ireland, but can I ask how abandoning a department that is scheduled to make a £15 million underspend and with serious issues in roads maintenance and street lighting in our community is doing what's right for the people in terms of public services?
Thank the member. I will remind the member, as a member of the DRD committee like myself, the committee unanimously asked the permanent secretary to go back to the minister and do a ministerial directive to spend an additional £20 million. So the concerns felt have not been shared in the committee meetings by the so-called member. And I would remind the member as well that on Lady Ulster this morning, that when he declares the in-out policy, the hokey-cokey policy, my party are out of the executive. We made that very clear in August. Over the past 6 weeks, we have watched the DUP ministers absent from responding to debates, absent from responding to questions in this Assembly, and yet we all witnessed in disbelief where the Minister came back to talk about the very urgent and important matters of as a draft renewables obligation closure, the credit unions and cooperative and community benefits bill, and last week the civil service bill.
Thank you. 1 minute.
Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm disappointed to have to take part in this debate because I'd hoped by now that common sense could have prevailed and we could have a functioning executive and assembly, particularly in the light of a dissident activity over the last few days where lives were very clearly put at risk. And we all know the danger of a political vacuum here in the north and who steps in to fill that vacuum. So, if for no other reason, Mr. Speaker, I would appeal to the DUP to get back to work. Many contributors to the debate thus far have outlined the challenges facing many of the ministers in their interests, not least, of course, health. And once again, we have seen and heard of job losses over the last number of days. We hear about potential investors who won't commit to that investment in the absence of political stability. So it is long past the time, and I think the argument as well made right across the political, civic and voluntary sectors, and indeed the business sector, as to why DUP ministers ought to get back to work. In the words, I think, of the Assembly Chief Whip of the DUP, their tactic is messy. He said that in an interview over the course of the weekend on the Politics Show, and I think many members, particularly those members of the DUP who do want to get back to work, do believe it's very messy and counterproductive. But it's not just, unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, counterproductive to all of those businesses, to the community, to the patients on the waiting lists, or to the homeless, or to those waiting to have announcements around benefits and pensions and housing. But it's to the detriment of us all, as the public loses faith in these institutions. And of course, Mr. Speaker, it was the will of the people and the votes of the people back in 1998 that established these institutions. And it's those people who have been most betrayed by the failure of making politics work here in the North. I listened carefully to the Sinn Féin contribution earlier, Mr. Speaker, but I can't help but reflect that some 2 years ago, I think it was, Sinn Féin blocked the executive from meeting for 3 months. So they have little at times to offer in the way of criticism that could be stood over. Because someone asked me, Mr. Speaker, whenever the recent crisis occurred, what did I think the DUP would do? And I said, well, they can't just block the executive. They'll do something like that, but they'll do it differently because Sinn Féin has already done that. So, you know, this is why we have such a messy situation, why some strategist at a very dark night, and not obviously performing at their best, came up with this ploy of in-out hokey-cokey ministers. So it does a disservice, not just to the people of Northern Ireland, but to all of us. I think we've also heard others say about how they're defending these institutions. Well, I don't know how they're defending them, because certainly there's quite a few weaknesses in the fortress surrounding these institutions because of the antics of some. And I think, Mr. Speaker, one of the greatest risks to these institutions is the failure of, in the main, I'd have to say, the two big parties in actually working together collaboratively. And that's why we have seen so many strategies stuck, particularly in the office of the First and Deputy First Minister. I mean, why can't there be an effective anti-poverty strategy, particularly in light of all the Tory cuts? And I welcome the current backlash that currently exists in England in relation to the attack on the tax credit system. And I do hope that particular cut is stood down, and I hope that the House of Lords, imagine people in the House of Lords, the most privileged of all backgrounds, one would think, might well be the last defence of those who are most vulnerable across England, Wales, Scotland and here in the North. So it's quite ironic, is it not, Mr. Speaker? In relation to earlier comments and my party and the issue around welfare, at least we didn't acquiesce on the issue of welfare. We are still in the business of seeking mitigation and in having a sensible way forward for the benefit of all, Mr. Speaker.
And I call Mr. Jim Allister.
Thank you. This is the time of year of falling leaves. Seldom can a First Minister have waited so anxiously beneath the fig tree in Stormont House to grasp the falling fig leaf to enable him to get back into government. And yet, patently, that is the ploy now afoot. DUP tell us, the Acting First Minister told us, that their partner in government is inextricably linked to the IRA. The Chief Constable told us that members of the IRA murdered Kevin McGuigan. The DUP said, in consequence, it cannot be business as usual. Hence, we become sometimes ministers, in and out, but always careful to preserve our pension continuity and our positions. And now tomorrow, maybe not, was to be last week, maybe it took a little more massaging than anticipated, but the panel report is to issue. And if the panel report can sanitize and present and suggest that, oh yes, there might have been a little recreational murder, but really, you know, the bigger picture is that these paramilitary organizations, they're really motivated, they've got the best of motives, and they really want to help the peace process, and in fact, it's a great idea that we have them. As Mr. Powell tried to tell us last week. And if the panel report does its business and provides the fig leaf, then rest assured, the DUP will be back in office, begging the question that if he couldn't have done business as usual because of an IRA murder, and if the panel, despite all the massaging, has to confirm it was a murder by members of the IRA, why, oh why, are they standing ready, brush in hand, to brush that murder under the carpet? Because that will be the consequence of the resumption of business as usual. The very thing that couldn't happen because of that murder, now it seems, under the fig leaf that they hope is going to fall into their hands, can be done despite that murder. In other words, sweep it under the carpet. And that's the spectacle that we're going to see, I believe, this week. And it is a spectacle which is wholly lacking in principle and lacking in sincerity, because it effectively creates the license to kill again. If a paramilitary organization can kill in those circumstances, and there are political consequences, and then the political consequences are ameliorated and withdrawn, what does that say to that paramilitary organization or any other paramilitary organization? Oh yeah, if you kill, well, we'll huff and puff, but we'll not really do anything about it. And when a decent interval of time has passed, we'll in fact carry on as if it never happened. By that very approach, a license to kill again is created. But of course, what does that matter in the world of political expediency, where the expedient is to avoid an election, cling on to office, and get back into full cohabitation with Sinn Féin? And that sadly is the DUP approach on this matter. Thank you.
And I call Mr. Basil McRae.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. An interesting debate thus far. People struggling to find some rational explanation as to why we've got into this place in this way. There are a number of people that I feel a little sorry for, and this may be somewhat surprising. Number one would be Simon Hamilton, who, as Minister for Health, I think has found himself in an invidious position. I actually agree with his points that he said in the briefing document here, that he says whether he's in the executive or not has no bearing on the standard of health care in the short term. But he is caught in this morass where his reputation is being trashed. Of all the winners and losers in this debate, I happen to think Simon Hamilton is the biggest loser of all. This was a man that was on the rise. This was someone who had a future opportunity. He'd been in lots and lots of different ministerial positions, and now he was going to go and do something. And together with his absence from the chamber and potentially with his association with other events being discussed by the Committee for Finance and Personnel, I think that he deserves the opportunity to come and explain himself. And yet, he's not able to do that because of party political positions. I also am interested, following on from the point that Mr. Alistair made, about where is the panel? Where is the three wise men that were going to come and tell us, is there an issue with paramilitaries or not? It was supposed to be last week, but now it's not even today, might be tomorrow. Who knows? The very issue that this crisis that was brought about has been forgotten. Even those parties that walked out on it, on that issue, are now caught up. Mrs. Kelly.
That in relation to the loyalist paramilitaries, we got the answer and the analysis from themselves last week when they came with their begging caps out, looking help to get out of extortion, drug dealing and other criminality. It seems a case in point that they're very much active.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, as Mrs. Kelly points out, there are many contradictions in this place that in any other part of the world you would look at in disbelief. But being here, we have some people say 17 years later we're going to stop doing bad things. Other people say we never did it in the first place. And you get this strange argument going on about what form of democracy we actually have here. Now, I was told the point that I was really wanting to come through on this issue was the whole crisis was based around some form of shooting and was there an allegation of paramilitary activity, was it still in place? And yet, it's gone. It's hardly mentioned. What we're talking about now is process. How are we going to deal with a non-functional executive? How are we going to deal with flags? How are we going to deal with the past? This is not what this crisis was about. This has morphed into something different. And I have to say, when I look at, in this very helpful pack provided by the librarian, one of the key issues that I have as a question for ministerial office holder is the pledge of office. To discharge in good faith all duties of office. Now, I want to know, does that stop the minute that you're no longer a minister? Do you say, ah, I'm no longer going to act in good faith? Mr. McKinnon.
The member be aware that under Articles 2 and 3 of 1.5 of the Ministerial Code, there is a duty to communicate with Assembly members and the public. And given the amount of times that these members have been out of the seats, is there a risk that these members have in fact breached the Ministerial Code?
Well, I'm going to read, I was coming on to the Ministerial Code. I will just say that 1.5.2 does state to be accountable to users of service, the community and through the Assembly for the activities within their responsibility. My argument is you can't just do it one day and then not the next day. And I am struck. The last point that I really want to make on this issue to do with the pledge of office is there is a pledge of office to support and act in accordance with all decisions of the Executive Committee and Assembly. Now, I have to say to you, I think on multiple levels, the ministers that are not here are failing to live up to these conditions. I'm quite happy to accept that there are serious political issues to be resolved. I think that there are some things that need to be brought to the fore and that we need to resolve them. But I think it is stating the obvious, but I will state it for the sake of clarity anyway. This particular strategy, whether well-intentioned or not by the DUP ministers, is backfiring spectacularly. There is not a person I talk to that does not say, this is wrong, this has exposed this place, and we really do have to do something to try and regain the trust of the electorate.
John McAllister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I do think, in looking at the strategy and debating this motion, we look at Beck and colleagues have all referred back to the events over the summer that were the pre-runner into this. I have to say, I've always taken the view on paramilitary activity, and that it is, and over the last number of years, become very clearly linked to criminality. If it was an act of brutal criminality that we had on our streets and the murder of Mr. McGuigan, that, to my mind, is a matter for the police to make sure that the police have all of the resources they need to investigate such a crime. If there are wider implications of organised crime there, then we have the National Crime Agency to investigate and to deal with that. But what it should not have, and never should have, should an act like that of brutal criminality should never have been in a position to bring down the entire government of Northern Ireland. And these institutions were hard won back in 1998. It's no surprise that I want to see them change and progress and evolve and normalise as much as possible. But a brutal act of criminality should not have brought down our government, should not have brought our government to its knees, should have not have brought this, the very being of this assembly, into question. So what of the DUP strategy of absentee ministers and in-out ministers? I don't think it is remotely helpful to this assembly, to the public at large. Look, I don't think it's remotely helpful to the DUP themselves. I think when you look there's some argument, well, what impact would a minister being in position, for example, over health services have? It has an impact when nearly 4 years into transforming your care strategy, and three ministers later, if you count Mr. Hamilton's continuous service, three ministers later, what have we delivered? What has our government delivered on that policy? We have now 20% of our population on a waiting list. At some point, looking at the size of our waiting list, what impact is this having on our economy? So we don't have an economy minister, apart from if he has a trip to go to China on. We don't have a health minister and says that has no impact. Meanwhile, we have people waiting, people who should and want to get their operation over and possibly back into the workplace, and companies depending on some people coming back to work. This is bound to have a detrimental effect on our economy. We look at the state of our economy. We haven't achieved the levels of growth when we look around the other parts of the UK, and we look down to the Republic of Ireland and heading for a growth rate of 6.2%, and yet where are we on any of that debate? The best our economy minister is doing is either his trip to China or bringing in legislation on credit unions before he then has to resign. All of this, and when we look at inward investment, the key drivers are about stability and delivering political stability and about delivering on skills. And where are we on any of those, Mr. Speaker? That is the impact that these are having. And we go across all of government. So Minister O'Dowd is bringing forward legislation on shared education, which I welcome and I want to see. But Minister O'Dowd can't get that out of the executive because it isn't meeting. So how do we progress on an agenda that we want to see moving on things that we do actually and can actually find agreement and some? It always reminds me of the major government when BSE hit in 1996, and they decided for a while they would veto all European Union rules, even the ones they agreed with. So we are now in this ridiculous situation where nothing is going through the executive. The executive isn't meeting, so nothing can go through it. And then we have ministers in and out, and the only thing they can come together to vote on is against a reduction in SPADs.
Councillor Fran McKenna.
Kian Corlea, and I raise to support the motion this afternoon, and I think there's been a lot of sensible stuff said here today, especially about the consequences of the resignations. And I was just looking there. I think if you take the Minister for Social Development and probably the rest, that they've resigned five times from the 10th of September. But I think what that really is a silly position been taken by the DUP on resigning their seats. It has not only made this place a laughing stock, but it has left everyone in this House open to ridicule. Their picking and choosing of when they are in and when they are out not only makes life difficult for the business of this place, but also it impacts their constituents. There does not seem to be been a pattern of the Minister's time spent in office. Some remain longer than others. Does that indicate that there's a difference of opinion in the ranks of the DUP about this? Since September 10th, this House has been held to ransom by the disruptive practice. There's no logic to what they are doing, and its only objective seems to disrupt the normal working in this Assembly. It has had serious implications for the smooth running of business and has delayed the passage of important pieces of legislation. A minister must be accountable to the users of services, the community, and through the Assembly for the activities which is within their responsibilities, which includes key performance targets and objectives that have been met. Now, that's in the pledge of office and other things within the ministerial code of conduct to ensure that all reasonable requests for information from the Assembly users of services and individual citizens are complied with. And the pledge of office says to participate fully in the executive committee. Surely these two aspects of public life have been upset by the activities of the DUP. There are many members who have been denied the opportunity. There are many members who have been denied the opportunity to question ministers on various aspects of their work, and the smooth passage of legislation has also been affected. On one of the seven principles of public life, on the head and accountability, it states holders of public office are accountable for their decisions and actions to the public and must submit themselves to whatever is appropriate to their office. Surely this has been denied to members with no availability to this chamber or at committee to tackle and challenge the minister. If one takes the passage of the Housing Amendment Bill, which will deal with antisocial behaviour and information sharing protocols, which could be lost because of the absence of the Minister for Social Development. My colleague, the Chair for Social Committee for Social Development, Alec Moskey, has done two things to try and ensure that bills are kept going, and that is to call the senior official to the committee to give us an RD rundown on what's happening, what decisions have been made, how the department is dealing with it. And he has demanded that someone attend the committee on a weekly basis to keep the committee informed on what decisions have been made. There was quite a lot said by the DUP about the perceived delays in the recent Red Sky inquiry, something challenged by the Chair, who also said at that time there needs to be we need to be able to get back to dealing with the serious question of housing on all its aspects, including the crisis in new build social housing, the future structures which will guide housing over the next 30 years, the serious flaws in the housing selection scheme, which condemns people to lengthy waits in housing. In my own constituency, over 4,000 people are on the waiting list, which is impacting socially on many families, either in hostels or in overcrowded conditions. The absence of the Minister for Social Development is denying me, as an elected MLA, to be able to question him on these matters. But there are also many other aspects of his ministry which affects the most vulnerable in society, such as dealing with deprivation and many other issues that come up at the committee. And I think it's about time that this nonsense was put an end to and that we get down to the real business, and that's protecting people out there who need protection.
And a comment, Mr. Tripp, conclude and wind on the debate.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I obviously support the motion to thank all those who have contributed today. I agree with Mrs. Kelly straight away. It's a pity we had to bring this motion. It's a pity Mrs. Kelly had to speak. I quite often say that. But really, the motion is really about the image of this place. Others have referred to it. And the image of this place as a legislator is just at an all-time low. It couldn't have got much worse. prior to this particular episode blowing up, but it has. The population is either indifferent or critical or just couldn't care less. The media is queuing up to poke fun at us or to pour scorn on us, more like. The business community is completely exasperated, frustrated, and they're fearful about the economy and the future. And our image across the world must be suffering through all this. We're also leaking money at £10 million a month. We have no executive meetings. It could probably go on for 10 minutes just being negative. But I mean, we've had so many standoffs and blockages at executive, and now we have rolling resignations, or hokey cookie, or in out, or a new one that came up today, yo-yo ministers. I like that one. Introduced by the DUP, following a formal resignation by the UUP, who's, frankly, I listen to Mrs. Dobson with a sense of irony, because their resignation was just as premature, even more so, and just as reprehensible. The question is, how does this affect the running of a department? That's really what it's about. And ministers in this place, I would say, are normally the busiest of all members. Ministers have the most onerous task and should be the busiest in their jobs, possibly with the honourable exception of yourself, Mr. Speaker. And they are supposed to adhere to a pledge of office. Now, others have mentioned sections of the pledge of office, but the meaning of the pledge of office is pretty clear. They're supposed to act with integrity and diligence and do their best in the interest of the people of Northern Ireland, the people who put them here and the people who they're supposed to serve. And are they really doing that when they're not attending briefings, they're not attending meetings, not attending events as ministers? They're not able to make decisions except on the hoof very quickly before they have to resign again. And they're not attending to legislation. There's been various instances quoted today by other members about legislative matters that had to be put back because we haven't got a minister. Mr. McKinney mentioned, as others did obviously, the health minister. This is the big one. And the assertion by DUP representatives that it doesn't really matter. It's relatively short term. And that whether the health minister is at his desk or not doesn't really affect waiting lists. Well, I'll tell you what, in the next DUP manifesto, if we manage to get waiting lists down, the health minister and the DUP will be taking credit for it. You can't have it both ways. We also have the unedifying spectacle, frankly, of the disagreements over are their salaries being paid in full, are they being stopped when they're out of office, the mention of pension rights, and the use of ministerial cars. Now, there's been a couple of instances there which have made me smile, at least. One of them was the attendance of a minister who was out of office at a cycling event. So we had the spectacle of his car being visible while his driver, his chauffeur, pumped up the bicycle tires on his bike. I mean, really? We have another instance where a minister who was out of office, but apparently coming back here to retake the pledge of office and pick up the reins of power again in his ministerial car from Ballymoney. I mean, really, this I don't like to use the word farce, because I'm just adding to the general impression that this is a farce, but really, and all this because a Republican was murdered, evidently by other Republicans. And in the DUP's case, their ultimate reason for withdrawing their ministers was the arrest, people taken in for questioning, of three senior Republicans, Bobby Storey, Eddie Copeland, and I just forgot the other fellow's name. It's so full of irony. I listened to Mrs. Foster at question time, telling Mr. Alistair off for being premature and wanting to bring this place down, and he should have waited for a report. According to Mrs. Foster and the DUP, the fact that Bobby Storey was taken in for questioning is apparently proof of guilt. You know, it just defies belief. This is a solicitor lecturing a barrister, actually. And, you know, what happened to the presumption of innocence in this country? You know, I mean, somebody being taken in for questioning should not, as Mr. McAllister said, in terms of a brutal murder, fair enough, should not be a reason for bringing down a government, or threatening to bring down a government, or threatening the institutions of a place like this. I would make the point too, how many murders have there been since the IRA ceasefire? I wonder how many murders there have been which were possibly committed by members or ex-members of the IRA. I wonder in the longer term how many murders have been committed by members or dormant members or ex-members of the UVF or the UDA. I mean, this panel report tomorrow may well be a very interesting document. But and I've heard so much condemnation of the particular murder of Mr. McGuigan, I can't help but wonder, where's all the condemnation of the murder of Jack Davison, which apparently precipitated that murder? I didn't hear hardly a word. So this is pick and choose, it's tactical stuff. The DUP wanted an excuse to take action on the back of the action that the UUP took, and they found this excuse that three people had been arrested, therefore they must be guilty. I could just run through quickly what members have said in the course of the debate. And Chris Little, in introducing it, talked about the discharge of duties in good faith. He made the case that many of one has made about the DUP turning up for certain motions and not for others, so it's okay to talk about SPADs, but it's not okay to talk about autism. I could make various comparisons like that. I also made the point that we would have favoured a short adjournment, but in no way did we ever agree to this kind of tactical nonsense that's been going on here for the last month or 5 weeks. Stephen, I knew, interjected and asked about a process for an investigation of breaches of ministerial code. Long overdue. He's gone, but he's right. Mrs. Dobson referred to the DUP's decision to withdraw their ministers and start this hokey-cokey nonsense as being undemocratic and un-British. Words fail me. That's a bit rich in the party who started this. Mrs. McCorley said that, well, said it wasn't good enough, mentioned the problem with DSD, junior doctors, transforming her care. She mentioned welfare cuts. The SDLP introduced welfare cuts as some kind of a reason to bring up in this debate. Welfare cuts is costing this country, our budget, £10 million a month because of Sinn Féin's obstinacy. Mr. Cochrane Watson, yes, I like this. He criticised Tommy Wilson's comments, which criticised his party. All he did was confirm, frankly, that unionism generally is all over the place on this. They don't know how they got here, and they don't know how to get out of it. Peter Weir, somebody mentioned that Peter Weir had called the situation messy. My goodness, messy is right, isn't it, Peter? I mean, really, it's a mess of your making. You can blame other people for it. Your party, sorry, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Weir's party made the decisions that have caused this mess. Mr. Alistair, well, frankly, he waxed lyrical about falling leaves and fig leaves. And I'm afraid after that I lost interest slightly because I've heard that speech so many times. We know where he's at on this. That's fair enough. Mr. McRae said he was sorry for Simon Hamilton. I think some of us would have a grain of sympathy for Mr. Hamilton. He clearly wants to be at his desk. John McAllister pointed out that this should have been left to the police. It's a police matter and never should have been allowed to bring down an executive for a government. And Fran McCann talked about this place being a laughingstock and all the problems of DSD at the present time. I wish I had 20 minutes, Mr. Speaker, but this just cannot go on. This is a farce. It's a DUP-instigated farce and it needs to stop. And hopefully tomorrow's panel report will be the beginnings of trying to stop it. So I support the motion.
The question is that the motion stand on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Clear the lobbies and the question will be put in 3 minutes. members resume their seats, please. Order. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Okay, do we have tellers? You almost tempted me there. Order. Order. Tellers for the ayes, Trevor Lunn and Kieran McCarthy. Tellers for the noes, George Robinson and Adrian McQuillan. Clear the lobbies, the Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left.
Secure the doors. Order, members. Clerk, please read the results.
88 members voted, 54 members voted aye, 34 members voted no. One member who voted in both lobbies is not included in these results. The motion is carried.
The motion is carried. Unfasten the doors. Item 5 in the order paper is the adjournment. The question is that the Assembly do now adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned. Thank you.